talk. So in the first talk, I explained how to construct derived category from abelian category. So so in the first talk, I wanted to explain also the triangulated structure, but I could not explain that due to the time limit. So today I start with this explanation of a triangulated structure of the derived category, and then I go to more real theorem. So the first one will be Brown representability theorem. So the first I will explain about compact object. So that today's plan is the first I talk about triangulated category. A triangulated category. And secondly, I explain about compact object. And third, Brown representability. So Brown representability is the existence theorem for right adjoint functor. And for example, the Grothendieck duality theorem is this kind of theorem. And also the existence of semi-orthogonal decomposition is also proved by Brown representability theorem. So it is a very powerful theorem, and there is some technique in the proof. But this technique is quite amusing. I mean, so it's a topological idea applied to algebra. So topological proof of Grothendieck duality, for example. And this is in Niemann's paper I referred last time. So this is Niemann's paper on Grothendieck duality. So many years ago, appeared many years ago in Journal of AMS. So this is the plan. So first last time I proved the following theorem. So if A is abelian category, and let com A be a category of complexes. So this is again abelian category. Then there is a functor from category complex to derived category satisfying the following property. The first property is that if F is in the home of COM, and if this is quasi-isomorphism, then the image of this morphism is isomorphism. So that means quasi-isomorphism in the category complex is we become isomorphism in the derived category. And second, if there is any functor from the complex category complex to another category C, such that F is iso for F quasi iso, then there exists unique functor G from derived category to C such that F is equal to GQ. So this is a universal property. So the derived category is in some sense smallest category which make quasi-isomorphism to isomorphism. So this is the same way as the localization of a commutative ring. But the category is non-commutative and also global, so it is more involved. Okay, so today I'd like to explain the triangulated structure of the derived category. So first I need some constructions Ah, by the way, I forgot to say that there are many different versions. So in this case, com means just the whole all complexes. But if I use, for example, com bounded, so this is bounded complex. That means at both ends only zero, only at the central part some only finitely many terms are non-zero. So this is bounded complex, and then what you get is bounded derived category. Or you may also consider like this. So this is bounded above. So in minus direction it can be infinite, but plus direction it is bounded. In this case it is bounded above, and then what you get is bounded above derived category. So these are defined in a similar way as this. So if you start with bounded complexes, what you get is bounded derived category, and so on. So the construction of first shift factor. So this one, so this already appeared. So if A is a object in complex, then A1 at ith part is A I plus 1. So this is shift functor, and that descends to the derived category. And another one is a mapping cone. So if A to B is a morphism of complexes, and then cone F is equal to A shifted plus B. So this is as a complex, as a module, it is a not module, but complex is a kind of a series of objects. So AIs are in A plus DI, AI plus 1. So this is the, you can consider complex as a graded differential object. So, and cone is as a graded module, graded object, it is just a direct sum. But the differential is given in the following way. So D of A n plus 1 B n is equal to minus D A n plus 1 F A n plus 1 plus D B n. So this notation looks as if they are modules, but they do not need to be module. A n plus 1 is a, so as if it is an element of A n plus, capital A n plus 1. But so even if they don't have any elements, so this notation works. So but with this way, it is easier to see. So this is mapping cone, and the picture is like this. So if A, A, this is A to this is B, then the mapping cone is like this. So first you consider like this. Yeah. So this is a quotient space of the cylinder, and this and identification. So this part is identified as point, and this part is identified by maps. So this is F. Yeah. So this is topological construction. So if you have a continuous map from between topological spaces, then you have always a mapping cone, and the algebraic expression is this. And there is mapping cylinder. So this is C of F. This is A plus A1 plus B. And the differential is given in the following way. D of AN N plus 1 BN is equal to D AN minus AN plus 1 minus D AN plus 1 F AN plus 1 plus D BN. And then there is exact sequence like this. So A go to cylinder F go to cone A. So cylinder is, in the case of cylinder, I don't need to collapse this part. So this cylinder is like this. So this is B A. So in the case of cylinder, so only at the bottom there is some identification, but other parts are just A. So all slices are A. So if you push the ceiling, then you can make it smaller and smaller, so that this cylinder is homotopic to B. So this is homotopic to B. Yeah. So that correspondingly, there is a quasi-isomorphism to the cylinder. So in the derived category, this sequence looks like this. But this is, so, of course, this doesn't make sense because this is a exact sequence of complexes. So this is okay. But in the derived category, there is no exact sequence. So this doesn't make sense. But this is true. Yeah. Now, so this is the cone construction and shift factor in the complex category. Now the derived triangulated category is so the axiom modeled after this construction. So definition. So T is triangulated category if the following conditions are satisfied. First of all, this is additive category, and secondly, there exists auto equivalence called 1. So this is just auto equivalence of the category, and third, there exists set of distinguished triangles. So distinguished triangles are usually written in this way, or A, B, C, and maybe this, like this. So to write this way in a A4 paper is more complicated. So in a paper, usually we like this. But this is better picture. So I have advantage of using the blackboard. So I can use this. Okay, and then they satisfy the following axioms. The first axiom, TR1, is the following. So AA0 is distinguished triangle, always. So here is this is the initial final object in the additive category. And moreover, if there is any morphism, then there exists distinguished triangle ABC. So this is the first axiom. TR2 is the following. So if ABC is a distinguished triangle, then BCA1 is also a distinguished triangle. So triangle can be rotated arbitrary times, but you need to put a shift functor. And this is if and not if. And TR3 is the following. So if, yeah, here it's better to see, to use a flat notation. So if there are two distinguished triangles, and if there are morphisms like this, which is commutative, then there exists always a third map, which make commutative like this. And this, so F and G are given, then there exists stage. Here it is F shifted by 1. So well, shift functor is auto equivalence. So if you have F, then always you have F1. So maybe, yeah, okay. So this is the, here one should note that this is not unique existence. So this is very important remark. So only exist, but it is not unique. So this is an important property of triangular categories. So this is usually called the weak point of the definition. And people do not like, some people do not like triangular category because of this. And people like prefer DG categories instead. Yeah, but the DG category is more complicated, and so have a lot of more so information which should be discarded. In some sense, it is better to consider triangular category and DG category at the same time. Okay, and the fourth axiom is called octahedral axiom, and this is a little bit complicated to state. So first I just state, then I'll explain the meaning. So if there exists A, B, C dash and B, C, A dash, so these are given, then there is B dash, exists B dash such that AC B dash and C dash B dash A dash. So this is very complicated, but these four triangles make octahedron. What is this? So yeah. And you can put this in a three-dimensional picture, and then some people like this three-dimensional picture, but I prefer another axiom which is easier. So this is called the nine lemma. What is the nine lemma? So there are nine dash, B2 dash, C, C dash, C2 dash. I even ignore the second next term. Next term is, of course, A1, but I even ignore. Then I have only nine terms. And suppose that three horizontal distinguished triangle and two vertical distinguished triangle. Then the third vertical is also distinguished triangle. So this is a nine lemma. So usually in nine lemma, so you have zeros out everywhere outside. And if you have exact sequences, three horizontal exact sequences, and two vertical exact sequences, and the third is also exact. So this is nine lemma. But in distinguished in triangle category, you need to consider distinguished triangles instead. So and one can prove that these axioms are equivalent. Now I explain the following theorem. So dx is triangulated. Yeah. So as I said already, that if you have a derived category, then it has a shift functor and cone construction. So that corresponds to the triangulated structure. So this is already given, so shift. But what is a distinguished triangle? So ABC is distinguished if and only if there exists an exact sequence A dash, B dash, C dash such that A, B, C, there are isomorphisms, compatible isomorphisms. So it says that any triangle is distinguished if and only if it is isomorphic to exact sequence of complexes. So this is the definition of distinguished triangles in the derived category. So in the derived category, I said that there is A and the cylinder and cone. And this is isomorphic to B in so this is quasi-isomorphic. And so A to B is arbitrary morphism. So it is not injective. So it is arbitrary homomorphism of complexes. So from arbitrary morphism, you can construct a cone like this. And then by this definition, A, B, and cone F is distinguished. So that's how distinguished triangles are defined. This is at the first glance it looks so it doesn't make sense because A can be bigger, so A is not injective in general. So but still you can embed this into injective homomorphism. So you can replace arbitrary homomorphism, arbitrary morphism between complex to injective homomorphism. So this is a good point and also a bad point. So you lose injectivity or similarly surjectivity in the derived category. So for example, in the Abelian category, so you have so remark, in the Abelian category, you have a simple object. So what is a simple object? Simple object is an object which doesn't have any sub-object. So non, of course, so zero is a sub-object. And S, so there is no S dash like this. So this doesn't exist. So this is a simple object. So for example, if R is a group ring, then so simple object in the category of modules, R modules, is nothing but irreducible representation. So in the representation theory, simple object or irreducible representation is a very important subject. And so because this is a ring, so you can define simple object and so on. But if you go to derived version, then you don't have simple object because you don't have any notion of sub-object or quotient object. But instead, for any morphism, you can always construct a cone construction.
Yeah. So, excuse me, yes? In the theorem, you mean dF instead of dx?
Ah, yes, yes. Oh, sorry, sorry. Yeah, you are right. Ah, thank you very much. Yeah. Yeah. I always consider the algebraic variety. So, So now, maybe, so now I explained the first axiom. So this one is also, it looks maybe strange, but by considering another construction, you can get this one. But how about the third condition? So third condition is quite important also. So maybe for example, suppose that you have vector space C, C2, C, so this is exact sequence of vector space. And then so this is A, and this is B. Then what kind of transformation is possible in the middle? So this is A, B, C, 0, something like this. And the C can be arbitrary. So in this sense, so these are distinguished triangles in the derived category of vector spaces. So this H is not unique, because I have this C always. Yeah. So this is TR3. Then what is TR4? So in the theory of modules, the most important theorem is maybe homomorphism theorems. Homomorphism So what is homomorphism theorem? So suppose that A is a submodule of B and a submodule of C. Then C divided by B is isomorphic to C divided A divided by C divided by B. So this is homomorphism theorem. Yeah, very simple but very useful theorem. So let A dash be the C over B, and B dash is C over A, and C dash is B over A. Then what happens is that so B C A dash yeah, actually that yeah this So A B C dash is A B the first triangle is this one A B C dash, and second one is B C A dash, this one, yeah. And the third one is this. Yeah, AC, ACB dash, and the C dash B dash, C dash B dash, A dash is nothing but B dash over C dash is A dash. And this is this. Yeah. So octahedral axiom is equivalent to homomorphism theorem. So it is I said that so A, B, C are just actually what I have at the beginning is just they are morphisms. Yeah. But as in the cone construction, I can change such that this is injective and this is also injective. So I have this situation. I can reduce to this situation. Yeah. So in this way, I have octahedral axiom. Okay. So and now from now on, you can only use these axioms. So yeah. Okay. Then. So. Using these axioms, you can prove many conclusions. For example, if there is distinguished triangle like this, then so F is isomorphism. Yeah, this is trivially true. But how to prove this? So, like this. So y 0 and x y 0 and x 0. So I construct nine lemma diagram like this. So this is equal, this is equal, and this is equal, this is equal. And this is f. So the middle horizontal sequence is distinguished by the assumption, and the top and bottom are distinguished by the axiom one. Okay, and then the how about this are distinguished. And this is, of course, distinguished.
This is not nine lemma. So, sorry, the vertical things are not distinguished. But anyway, there are,
So these are not known, actually. Yeah. So I use the second axiom. Or third axiom, TL3. I use TL3. Yeah. So this is distinguished, this is distinguished, this. And if there are two morphisms, then I have third morphism by TL3, such that these are commutative. Yeah. And then by using the first commutativity, so FG is identity. And by the second, this one, so HF is identity. And then if I consider HFG, this is HF is identity, so this is G, but FG is identity, so this is H. So H and G are equal. So I have inverse morphism. So GF is isomorphism. So like this. So using a diagram chasing and using the axioms, you can get this kind of trivial looking statement easily. So now I have exercise. So first exercise is the following. So suppose you have distinguished triangle, and then there is long exact sequence. So home XA, home XB. So X is arbitrary. X is arbitrary. So T. Home XC, and then home XA1, home XB1, and so on. So this is usual long exact sequence. But usually, home next one is extension, but just one shift. But as I said, you can so if X and A, these are modules of a ring, then this is extension one, the same as extension. So what you have to prove is only that the exactness at here. If you can prove exactness at one point, then the next one is just rotating the distinguished triangle. And this is proved by using TR 1 and 2. So the second question, so cone F is uniquely determined up to isomorphism. Which is not unique. So that means if you have a morphism like this, F, and then you have a cone of F, and maybe cone dash of F, so both are distinguished triangle, then there exists H, which is isomorphism. And this H is not unique. Okay, so this was the triangle category. Yeah. So are there any questions? Okay. So then I need to explain the derived functor. So suppose you have A to B, so semi exact functor. So for example, left exact functor. For example, F something is home of maybe X and something like this. So X is in A and B is the maybe set or vector space. So K module. So functor home is left exact. Okay. So from this, if you have a left exact functor, then you get exact functor in the derived category DF from DA to DB. So what is exact functor? Exact functor is a functor which so commute compatible with the shift and the distinguished set of distinguished triangles. So these are the structure of the triangular category. And the functor which is compatible with the structure of the triangular category is called exact. So that means DF of A1 is DF1, DFA1, and so on. And distinguished triangle is mapped to distinguished triangle. And how to construct this kind of thing is the following. So there is also a universality. So this is actually a theorem. So there is a theorem. So D from DA to DB satisfies first. DB, yes. Such that com A to DA and com B to DB, and this is F, and this is DF, and this is commutative. And this is localization map. This is first condition. The second condition is that if there is another, so I use maybe, yeah, if there is, sorry, if there is another morphism, exact functor, then there is Sorry. This is not true. So if there is another functor G which make this commutative, then there exists a morphism from DF to G. So morphism of functors. Now this is universality. Yeah. Okay. Then how to construct derived functor? So there is so-called K-injective resolution. If you have any complex, there exists I, which is again com, this is K injective, and A to I is quasi isomorphism. So, what is K injective? K injective means that if X is a cyclic complex, then hom of X to I is a cyclic. So these are all in terms of complexes. So not in derived category. This is the statement for the complexes. So acyclic means its cohomology is trivial. Yeah. And then this homo dot, what is homo dot? This is a graded homomorphisms. So for example, hom I xi is hom xi shifted by I. Sorry. Maybe this is not true. This is HI. Is this true? Sorry. Maybe this is true. Yeah, and then I have to check. Sorry. I forgot. Maybe, do you know anybody? I think this is homology, yeah. But I forgot. But this is strange, yeah. This is strange, yeah. Sorry. So there is some kind of construction like this. For example, if you consider only bounded complex, so in the case of bounded complex, so K injective is just equivalent saying that all components are injective. So this is usual injective resolution. But if you consider unbounded complex, then it is more complicated. So you need to consider K-injective complex. But anyway, by using not only injective resolution, but the K-injective resolution, you can still define derived functors in the same way. So even if it is unbounded, so in the same way as bounded complex. Okay, by this way, and also instead of right derived functor, so this is usually wrote by right derived functor. But if F you started is right exact, then you can define left derived functor, for example, tensor product. So like tensor product is right exact, and in this case you should define left derived functor. But in this case you need to use K projective resolution. But then anyway, so this is the way to handle unbounded complex, and in the Brown representability theorem, unbounded complex is important. So that's why I wanted to say this kind of expression. Now I'd like to go to the next section. Are there any questions? So section two. So, and one is compact object. So, let T be a triangle to category. Then, what is coproduct object? So coproduct is like this. So AI. So I maybe lambda. Lambda belongs to index set. So each A lambda is a object. And this is So the coproduct satisfies the following universality. So for coproduct to any other object is product of home A lambda B. So lambda is in lambda. So this is the definition of the coproduct. Of course, the coproduct doesn't may not exist, but I assume that the coproduct exists. So, for example, if T is the derived category of modules, so arbitrary modules over R, then the coproduct is nothing but the direct sum of modules. And this direct sum can be arbitrarily infinite, arbitrary members, so not only countable, but uncountable, and so on. Yeah. And then this equality is clear, because in the direct product, so in the direct product, you have almost all zeros. But only finitely many non-trivial entries, and all zero otherwise. So if you have an individual map, so A goes to maybe B, B lambda, and this goes 1, B lambda 2, and so on. And then you can just add image to get this. Yeah. So if you have infinitely many entries, then you cannot add them. So this one doesn't map to this one. So that's why I need coproduct instead of product. And then the definition of a compact object . So A is called compact if A So usually this kind of so there is a map from here to here maybe. Here to here. There is always a map from here to here, because this is nothing but the product. Not product. So here you have finitely many non-zero homomorphism from A, and so you get from A to B usually. So there is map here, but the compactness says that it is bijective. For example, if A is like this, then this home contains, so home contains identity element, but identity element is non-zero for all indices. So that doesn't belong to this. So it is not surjective. Yeah. So in the if A is infinite coproduct, then this doesn't happen. So compactness means very strong strong sense of finiteness. Yeah. And then, so TC is a set of as object. This is the compact object. And this is full subcategory of C. So full subcategory is determined by identifying the set of objects. Okay. And T is compactly generated. If for all A in T, there exists B in TC such that form BA is non-zero. So this is the definition of a compactly generated category. And now I give you an example. So X is a projective variety. And T is the unbounded derived category of quasi-coherent sheaves. So this is quasi-coherent. So quasi-coherent sheaf corresponds to arbitrarily generated modules. And so, for example, if X is spec of some commutative ring R, then M is R module of arbitrarily generated, then M tilde belongs to the quick of X R tilde 0. So, and vice versa. Yeah. Okay. So, in this case, what is compact object? Yeah. So, F in com of coherent X is called perfect if it is a bounded complex of locally free sheaves. So it is very, very nice object. So in the general definition, so if you don't assume that X is projective, but something like a quasi-separated, quasi-compact scheme, then perfect means locally isomorphic to bounded complex of locally free sheaves. So it is not globally isomorphic to bounded complex of locally free sheaves. But so it is just unnecessary complication, so I assumed projective variety. And in this case, it is just like this. Yeah. So then, there's a theorem. So if T is the Q coh X, so X is projective, then T is perf X. So this is the full subcategory of bounded complex of coherent sheaves, consisting of perfect complexes, TC. So perfect means compact. Perfect and complex. compact is the same. And this holds for more general situation also. So I refer to Bondal Vandenberg paper for more more general case and its proof. So I don't give you the proof of this, but I just give you some hint. So, namely, so suppose A is perfect, then it is compact. So why is this? So A is a bounded complex of locally free sheaves, so like this, so A0. It doesn't have to start with 0, but just simplicity. A, M, and 0, like this. So suppose that A is like this. Yeah. And then there's a map like this. So maybe, sorry, here A, M minus 1, 0. So from this shifted sheaf, so this is locally free sheaf, they're just shifted. So and so this complex maps to this complex because 0 goes to 0 like this, so it is commutative. So it is commutative. And the quotient, sorry, so quotient is like this. So this is quotient. So I write this A, and this is AM minus M, and this is A dash. So there is exact sequence like this. AM minus M, A to A dash. So this is exact. Exact sequence of complexes. Okay, then I need to check the perfectness. So it is by induction. So by induction on M. So suppose A, M is 0, then so A is just locally free. See? Then from A to B lambda is just gamma A star tensor B lambda. Yeah. And tensor commute is coproduct. So this is coproduct of gamma X A star tensor B lambda. So this is home of A to B lambda, coproduct. So in this way, it is compact. So now, by exact sequence, home of AM B lambda M home A B lambda. And I have a commutative diagram like this. A, M, B lambda M, Yeah, this is just, this is like linear algebra. So it is easy to see, but difficult to write. So like this. So, and also here, one shifted, and this is again, so something. So I just write here from AM P lambda M plus one, like this. Yeah, from AM V lambda M plus one. Yeah. Now by induction argument, these are isomorphisms. And so the center is also isomorphism by five lemma. So the compactness of a perfect complex is easily proved. And the opposite, converse, and so on, I want to refer to Bondal Vandenberg paper. Okay, this is the end of the compact object. And then maybe I don't, so sorry, it is behind the schedule. So there is a the construction, for the construction I need so-called homotopy limit. So this is very useful idea from topology and used for the proof of the Brian representability theorem. So suppose that you have a sequence of object, this is just a sequence of morphisms in a triangular category. So, and I want to construct some inductive limit. Yeah. So, what is inductive limit? Inductive limit is a quotient of coproduct. Yeah, so if it exists. So in the inductive limit, the direct sum is modeled by relations induced by the maps. So this is inductive limit in the usual sense. But there is no quotient in the triangulated category. So actually there is no limit in the usual sense, so in the strict sense. So there is no universal, there is no limit which satisfies universality. So it's a rather bad situation. But still, one can construct homotopy limit, which is not strictly universal, but it is almost universal when the category is compactly generated. So this is quite interesting argument. So what is this? So homotopy limit holding on BI is, this is a cone of so ID minus shift from coproduct to coproduct. So if this is D1, D2, and so on, then the morphism, so is like this. So if you, so this is, so yeah, so there is PI from coproduct to each component, and then ID minus shift is the following. So this is coproduct of pi minus bi mi b bi pi minus 1. So pi sends bi to bi, and bi to bi minus 1 is pi minus 1, and then bi is, this is bi. So this target of these are the same, and make the difference, and then summing up all argument I, and then you get this map. And take cone. So cone means in some sense it is quotient. Yeah. Quotient of the coproduct. But actually the generalization of quotient. And the kernel is the difference. So this is usually gluing of the direct limit. So this is a substitute of direct limit. But since the cone is not unique up to unique isomorphism, this is not universal. Yeah. But up to isomorphism, they are unique. Yeah. So it is not functorially unique, but it is in some sense unique. But then, yes.
Do you want this to be called homotopy limit or homotopy
co-limit? Homotopy co-limit, yes. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. So direct limit is co-limit, and the projective limit is a limit. So this is So change of the direction. Usually, projective limit is limit, and a projective limit is called inverse limit also, and direct limit is direct. So, but limit is inverse limit, and co-limit is limit. So. Okay. Then there is an important lemma. So if A is compact object, then the limit, there is a limit actually, limit of home from A to BI is equal to home of A to homotopy co-limit of BI. So this is if you consider if you restrict to compact object, then it is really good. Yeah. But as I said, for example, if X is smooth and projective, then DB of X is equal to perfect complex of F. And this is inside D of Q cock X. So this is important object for algebraic geometry. But this itself doesn't have a coproduct. So you cannot construct anything inside this. So if you take coproduct, then you have to consider also this big category. And then inside this big category, this subcategory is identified as a subcategory of a compact object. And you can return from here to here by taking compact object. And compact object behave very well for limit. Okay, so there is a long exact sequence home of A, BI, home A, BI, form a homotopy colimit. Homotopy colim. So there is a sequence coproduct to coproduct and cone, and since A is compact, this coproduct can be moved out of the bracket. So there is long exact sequence like this. Okay, and so if here you take Fi, then it goes to Fi minus Bi Fi minus 1 by definition. So this map is defined by this. So if I compose F with Pi, then what I get is Fi. And then, first of all, it's better to write here, from A to coproduct 1. So I claim that this is injective. So why is this? So this is F0, F1, and so on. And this is F0 and F1 minus B1 F0, F2 minus B2 F1, and so on. So suppose that this is 0, then F0 is 0. Then F0 is 0, then F1 is 0, and so on. So this is injective. What I am considering is a very special case. So this is a sequence which is bounded below. So if sequence is just unbounded in both sides, then this argument doesn't work. But so in this special case, this is injective. So again, the next one is also injective, something like home. So since this is injective, this is surjective. And this is zero. So this is exact sequence, actually. This is short exact sequence. Short exact sequence. So that means that this is injective limit. So this is nothing but home API limit. Okay. It's already time is over, so I just state the theorem of the, and I postpone the proof in the next week. So just I state the Brown representability theorem. So T is triangulated and coproduct and compactly generated, and the T dash is also triangulated and coproduct. So it doesn't mean necessary to be compactly generated, and F is a exact functor. Such that it preserves coproduct. that means f of some coproduct, arbitrary coproduct, is equal to like this. And then there exists right adjoint. From T dash to T. So right adjoint means that if you have F A B in T dash, this is equal to A G B in T. Yeah. And for example, in the Grothendieck degularity theorem, so if f from x to y is a projective morphism, then Rf star has adjoint, right adjoint, if apatric. So this is the Grothendieck duality theorem. So I will explain more about this, and also why this is sufficient. Actually, for the most application, this is only the thing. More detailed description of the dualizing sheaf is also obtained by using this. Sorry for overtime again. Yeah.